Very good. I hope you can hear me like this. Here now, I'm just here attaching here some things here in order that we can see and hear each other. And now I'm just trying to transmit and record like this. Let's see. Oh no, I just put on my apron and I want to put in the purfling here. The apron you can find also on my web shop, on my homepage. On the one you get is not dirty. This one is a little slightly dirty because I'm working with it, so I don't get my shirt dirty, but you can get the new one. It's out of 100% cotton, and my sister puts on here the writing, the best sound of Cremona, and things like this. Yeah. So this one here should be hot. Let's see if this is hot enough with some water. We check, it should be 180 degrees. Yeah, that's perfect. Okay. So then we have here this bowl with water. And I first bend here the purfling for my Storioni. Lorenzo Storioni is the violin I'm making a copy of. This is a nice book which I got a few years ago, and I really had fun. Arte mio Versari and three centuries of Italian violin making. It's actually not a super serious book, but it's somehow the instruments which are inside, I somehow like them, and so I very often made the testore, which you can also purchase, and I even have the pieces over there, and you can get the testore. And then I also, the Stradivari, this one, 1727, I don't like that much. But the Storioni, I really enjoyed making it. It's an interesting model because it's, how should I say? It's the mixture between Stradivari and Guarnieri. And once you're here in Cremona and you realize how small this town is, years ago, certainly they had also this little town, everybody probably knew everybody. Now we are here like 70,000 inhabitants in this little town. And at the time of Stradivari, that was certainly probably maybe 15 or 20,000, but it was actually considered a big town. And Storioni was actually a pupil of Stradivari and Guarnieri. And so you could easily imagine he was in Sesto, which is where Andrea Varazzani, for instance, is, he's also here at the show, is working. It's a little bit out of town. Andrea Varazzani felt a little bit far away, but Lorenzo Storioni was also there, so it's actually Cremona, you know. So this guy, probably Lorenzo Storioni, 1781, probably walked back and forth. 1781, his masters were already gone, but he made these his instruments with the shape is a little bit from the Guarnieri and the. The precision is like Stradivari, so it's somehow interesting. Just have here some things which I want to do nice. Actually, I still have to finish the corners. I do only the channel and the upper, lower, and C-bout rough, and then I still have to make it a little bit better. Now I just want to bend here all around better. and clean it a little bit because it's all rough. I did it already beforehand, and now I'm doing it like this, which goes quick. Probably my colleagues here are all looking. If you are interested of how I'm actually doing my instruments, and you are a maker and you want to get more technical support, you can also write on my check out on my Patreon, and then you can get models and varnish secrets for the VIP patrons and things like this, huh? While if you want to have a super great sounding violin like the Storioni, you get a violin which has an extremely powerful E string. It's probably one of the models which increases the most this super strong E string. It's like a never ending E string, extremely powerful. And that's why I make this, I like this Lorenzo Storioni model that much, because it's so powerful E string. Yeah. And certainly we want to have a nice corners. He made it actually quite beautiful corners. Yeah. Here, there's one more. And this one is here. So this looks like this here. Yeah, I don't know if you can see that. Probably you cannot see, it's not clear enough. But then I take these purflings and I want to see how this one goes in. This goes in very nice. Need better glasses here. And I actually have more than one glass, so then I can see better what I am doing. Yeah, with this one I see better. And sometimes I put two glasses, you know, to make the purfling, then I can see very precise. So, but this one here actually goes in very well. This is good. So with this one, I can bend a little bit here. Just want to do something like this. Yeah. Now I have to clamp the bending iron to the working bench. Let's see if this works like this. So then the bending iron is about 180 degrees, okay. And this helps that you can bend the purfling but also the ribs easy. Yeah. And it has the shape of a C here, this here. So you can, like this here, having the C like this. And now I just bend the C. I don't know if you can hear that, how it is nicely. Can you hear that? Yeah. And that goes very quick. Like this. Mm-hmm. Until it is nicely banded and follows nice there. And then we just do it very rough, only inside, yeah, and then I focus on the corners, I cut them and I fit them inside, yeah. There's just something I want to make slightly better here. This is better. You can hear the water, how it is. This, and then we go, we make the upper and the lower part just very quick here, nothing super fancy, just very general fitting. Here we can make an interruption. Okay, so maybe we make here another C here for the back, and then I'm making violins already since 1984. So how many years are this? 36 years. And I really enjoy it extremely. The most important or most interesting thing in violin making is that it is so such a complex trade. It really is. I couldn't make a living without, I couldn't live without making violins, and I couldn't imagine a different work. I just love it. It includes so many aspects of life, from chemistry, physics, taste, style, culture, travel, fairs around the world, and even now virtual. Isn't that great? It just showed me so many people around the world that it is incredible. Yeah. This here. The violin I'm making here, this is a Lorenzo Storioni. And This one will become a master violin of mine, which goes for, here in Europe, 27,275 euro. And this was actually last year's price, and now after the show then it will be raised slightly. And right now for the show, for you, without consumption tax and in US dollars minus the consumption tax, but not in euro but in US dollar, it's 27,440 US dollars. Yeah, so this is a the best you can get, and this is an instrument where you get also a double certification, a certificate which I issue plus a certificate which is issued by the Consortium of Violin Making, which means that it's not the certificate which is making the instrument good, but it's a guarantee, additional guarantee, that it is an original instrument made by myself here in the workshop. So when I start, I send pictures of that wood to the consortium, and and then a commission is passing by, checking if I make everything how it should be, because nasty competitors in the market believe that in Cremona people only put inside the instrument Cremona and so on. But for those who are really interested and know what we're doing, it's more than evident that to get a certain quality, you have to make it yourself. Quality is not a matter of luck, okay? So this is just my personal opinion. This already all a few weeks ago, because we were somehow very anxious that we have to go into a second now serious lockdown. In March and April, Italy was in a lockdown like nobody else or few other countries have been. And we couldn't move at all from our houses, so we were blocked inside. Only later on then, violin makers, since we are producing, could go back to work, and that's how we are right now. And then they started to give areas certain colors. And I really hope that you're now doing already somehow better, because California is right now pretty serious situation there, yeah. At the time we were locked in our countries, in our houses over there, people thought that something like this will never happen. And now worldwide we're all in the same situation. But it helped us to create new opportunities, and even me here in violin making, I'm here doing new things, right, which is also interesting. But certainly we would have loved to work for this kind of things later on in a few years, but it has accelerated somehow some things, right? Oh, the lamp is just in front of my face, so you don't see me even while I'm bending here. It's really hot. It's 180 degrees Celsius. Yeah. This one is a little bit too low. We just throw it. Yep. So, I hope you can see me well in this situation here. Need to see the violin, how that looks like. Smaller parts. This purfling is actually seems to that it doesn't have any reason that it's inserted, but it protects later on when the purfling is glued in that the instrument is cracking from the sides, because this is spruce and would crack very easy. On the back, then same reason, but less important compared to on the top. That's why Testore, for instance, didn't put it on the back at all. He just signed it, he scratched it on the back. And I also made it like this on the Testore, which is like this one here. Here I have to show you. Can show you, this is the Testore, for instance, and I don't know if you can see that here, there is the purfling inserted, how you can see me how I make it, and it's a very typical nice Testore. I made the video about how I made this. This has also a fancy tailpiece which I carved myself. And then on the back side here, you see also the purfling, but it is actually only scratched, but it's not cut in. So, and Testore himself, he made it this way. So I also scratch it like this. You see all the tool marks, very fancy, like the Testore, which I saw in Venice. And here, this is the brand mark he put it on. Carlo Antonio Testore. Yeah. Hope you like that. Oops, I have to tune it. Huh? Oops. Yesterday we made a movie about it, how to pull up the strings, and now it's completely down. Let me see. We have all kind of okay, so here there is a problem with this peg. I have to adjust that one. What is here not correct? Probably how I put it, the string on it. So we'll see once again. To adjust the bridge like this. Very powerful violin. I will put the video, the link of when Lena plays it. And very powerful. Yeah. To listen to my instruments, you actually just go on my website, and in the gallery as area, there are actually all the instruments which you can listen to the different models. And in the web shop, you can see the instruments which are available. I am sorry, I don't have too many instruments right now available. I, instead of finishing many instruments for this specific date, I try to bring many instruments to the same point so that if you are interested, that you can actually tell me what kind of instrument you would love to get your violin made, and then I just would make it for you, and I would forward you pictures and things like this from the process of making the instrument. Yeah, this is how I thought I will do it, because otherwise I wouldn't have been able to prepare all this. Here I band all the purfling, all the filetti, how we call it in Italy. And then I have one C, I just make one more, you never know, you know. And then I start sitting down and cut my channel inside, and then I see how this works, yeah? So this is this one. Yeah. And now this one is like 28, 29 minutes. So then I will interrupt and I make a new one. So here I sit down and I start to make one corner after another. And then I show you how I do this. Right? Just need the leather and maybe a nice knife from Min. It's also something good. And then I have my favorite tools here, like this. And I take away this one here. It's far too much here on the working bench right now. Yeah. So a nice instrument actually is a good long-term investment. Don't laugh. This is my special lens to cut my F-holes, to cut my channel. Yeah. And then before I make the whole thing, I always look at the violin, how it looks like. And it's difficult to transmit this now here in this transmission here during the show, but now, to get a nice corner, how to cut the whole channel here is actually the whole secret. Because if the channel is not cut well, the whole corner won't turn out nice. So I cut one here and one here. While I'm working here, I forget that I'm here live on the NAMM show. It's a pity that I can't transmit exactly. How I make this here. So I show you how I make this whole purfling. Would be nice to show you my working bench here with all these cuts in the working bench, and you can tell how many purfling I cut in my life yet, because here you can see actually all the tool marks while I was working in the past 30 years on this working bench, and it's all full of these cuts here. Yeah. So this is one thing, and then here I make the other one. To show you, maybe you can see it then in the camera better, what I did actually. Now I have to insert the C, upper and lower I've cut already. And now I make the C. And I want to show you so that you have an idea what I'm doing here. Make it here nice because I want to show you what I'm doing. I'm not happy. You know, it's because of the live transmission that I want to show you what I'm into here. This, now we cut it into the right length, which is always a tricky part. Oops, and it's too short now. It would be nice if you could see what I'm doing here. Maybe we can do that in a way that I have a better way to show you. Let's see if we can do that. I bring this a little bit closer. Like this. Yeah. And then we go down here. It's not so easy, huh? Can we maybe you see something? I don't know. Let's keep it like this. Let's see if we can do that. Like this. Now I sit down here like this and I show you what I did here. So this is the purfling of the top, right? And the lower part I leave inside, and then I show you how this is looking like, okay? So I put now, I cut here these ends very precisely. There are three color, black, white, black, okay? And then I put it inside here into the corner. And then I come with the C, which I also have cut in a different way and in an exact length to fit and to make a nice corner in the upper and in the lower area, okay? Then I put them in here like this. Now, I don't know if you can see that. And then this one here we keep like this, and that one I put like this, okay? And then actually I'm very happy like this, so now I wanted to show you this, and let's see if you can see this. Should be able to be seen like this. So I just adjusted the upper, the lower, and then I fit in this one, yeah? So I still have to glue it in. On the other side here, you see that it still has to be adjusted. So now I have to cut the other side. Yeah, I still have to cut my corners and things like this, yeah? I hope you like that. Like this. Is this a nice idea of seeing it like this? So you can watch me how I'm doing here actually my purfling. Okay. And I have two glasses. I still have to cut the channel here, which is for me the very last part of purfling, and because some people put the glue already inside and then cut the whole channel. It would be for me a little bit too stressy, but it's a system. You just get used to it, to your own way of making, okay? And the old style, how Stradivari and Guarnieri and all those makers made it, was completely was different. This would be the better word, because at the time they didn't make the modern violin how we know it today, but they only constructed baroque violins. Yeah, and so the neck was not inserted into the body after it was finished and closed, but they glued on the top, the back to the ribs, and then they nailed the neck to the ribs. And so because of that whole procedure, they put it the purfling once the instrument was actually already finished. And nowadays there are some makers who are very proud that they do the whole system exactly that, in this consequence, which is a certain very traditional way. But actually, to be honest, I think this doesn't make any sense. And well, you get used to it, and I don't want to judge now, but actually there is no reason to do it. And it takes you away a little bit, the possibility to have things better under control. And since nowadays we are control freaks, and as soon as we walk 500 meters, we need to track our movement. In violin making, that means that we want to have everything under control, right? And so I prefer to have things better under control. Here you can see how I cut now the corners very nice, okay? And now I insert my purfling into this channel here, okay? So maybe I go a little bit closer, like this, then you see it better, okay? And yeah, now we cut this one here.
me see if it's long enough. A little too short. Make it look longer. This is one, and this is two. Now I always make this one here first. Let's see. You can find me also on YouTube. I have a lot of videos here, there on YouTube to show you what it depends on to make a good sounding violin. And I enjoy doing that. I do that with my daughters together, and they're really helping me very much, and they're doing a great job. To glue them in, actually, then I don't take the whole thing out anymore. Now I have fitted the corner up here, and then I make it another one here. This one here I make now too long because I saw that it needs a little bit of tension. Let's see how this one fits in here. One here and one here. Oh, actually, it's good. Yeah. Very good. So then here I just have to make it the right length. Here on top and back, you actually don't have the problem to make a super nice and precise joint. Because on the upper part here comes in the neck, and on the lower one there is the saddle, the lower nut, so you don't need to make it super precise, but you know,
Yeah, that's good, huh? And this is when it is fit inside precisely. So then I have the corners here and the corners there of the Lorenzo Storioni violin. Yeah.
This is the top. And then I still have to make the back here.
Let's say here I have also another violin. This is the Ole Bull. Then on the Ole Bull, for instance, I make even here, you know, you can see how this is going up and then down and then up and things like this. And I just do it exactly how the original is. And then here some holes and the purfling exactly the same way, just like the original. So you get exactly something like it is in the book, and the Guarnieri high fets is different than the Isaé or the Lafont or the Sainton. And I can show you here also, like this is the Guarnieri Isaé. So here you see how it is made here with all this channel and holes and cuts out. It's just the same way how it is in the book. Yeah. And it goes like this all the way around. And then here on the top, you have even these super consumed corners and tiny spots and holes. And it looks like it is a super antique violin, right? But it's completely new violin, and you can listen to this one. Yeah. It's in the products, this one. It sounds a very powerful, rough violin. I think it is really good sounding one. Hmm? The Guarnieri Sainton is this one, okay? So we go here a little bit. Like this, How do you think that would look like? Yeah. It's not so easy to make this here so good looking. Oh, this is good. This is better. Yeah, so this is better view up, and then we have it here like this, and then you have here the entire vision. So I still cut here. How you can see, I have two glasses. Sorry, don't laugh too much about it, but otherwise I don't see enough. And this one we can glue in later on. And so it's the reason that I want to show you is that we make it here completely by hand. And then I want to understand which one is first and which one is later. And this one is the first one. Okay. Yeah. Here I still have to do a lot of cutting of the channel, but we just do it here. And meanwhile, you can talk to me, right? And make me questions.
Here I was lazy in this corner and didn't do that. Actually, I brought a lot of instruments to this point, because then actually I thought that during an eventual another lockdown I would sit at home and I'm not able to go back to work, and then I can make my channels even on the kitchen table, you know. This was a little bit the idea, so I didn't focus on making all the instruments completely finished for you now. And especially I have the impression that people appreciate to make part of it, of the process of their new instrument which is going to be made for them. So that's why I focused on bringing many instruments to that point. So in the very beginning I thought jointing the top, for instance, is something I can't do at home. I need many clamps, big plane, a stable table where I can hold very well the pieces while planing them. So I started planing a lot of wood, choosing the wood which I can't do when I'm in a lockdown, and so on. So I was Storioni even too nice, seems like a Stradivari corner. And this is actually what I did in the past few months, beside that I finished instruments for customers. And that's actually my strategy, okay? And then I dedicated time to make the configurator, so you can also choose the color of your varnish. My master instruments always are varnished with oil varnish, since I believe that the great masters actually used oil varnish. And I have the idea that an oil varnish makes a better sounding instrument, actually the varnish is not really responsible for the sound, but for sure the great masters used the oil varnish, so no doubt about that. So I think we are just closer to what the great masters did. And I think for an instrument of this price category, it's important to offer you exactly the last up-to-date standard of this kind of level of instrument.
On the Scala Perfetta and Linea Macchi, which are lower grade instruments, I somehow
think it is good enough to have a oil varnish,
a spirit varnish. And
the advantage of doing with spirit varnish those instruments is that actually it's easier for me to tell my employees here how they have to do and what they have to do. So I just could tell them, okay, let's put on some more yellow varnish. And they take the jar, one of these ones here next to me, and then they just put it on and that's it, you know. While on the oil varnish, it's a little bit more complicated. You cannot prepare a jar of color varnish, a big jar, and then everybody varnishes with that one. It doesn't work because the pigments would go down. So every time you have to mix a little bit again. And this creates already a little bit a different process of working. And if you have people working with you or for you, you need to keep them, their hands busy, right? So that's why I also continue with the alcohol, with the spirit varnish. Spirit or alcohol is the same, okay? And it's easy to prepare once you have written how it is. You just put all these things together and it works. Yeah. If you want to get my recipes and if you want to see how I make my varnish, you have to become a member on Patreon, and then you get all the details of varnishing and especially the wood preparation, which is what I'm doing actually on my instruments, because one of the secrets of the Cremonese makers in the past has been that they had, as from a certain time, they had a specific wood preparation starting to use that one. And that's from 1686. That's Stradivari and all the other makers in town. You can tell that he has changed something in his process of varnishing, and the appearance of the varnish is getting different. And there is a very thin layer of protein being applied on the wood. And at the time they did that, they didn't think of a secret or anything. They just applied it because they discovered that if they put some of this preparation, then the oil varnish doesn't penetrate into the small tiny holes of the wood. Because if you would put some oil on a piece of wood, it would leave a very nice spot, right? Because the oil is soaking in. And when you varnish your violin, you don't want to have a violin which is soaked with your varnish. You'd want to have a layer of varnish on your instrument, but not, you don't want to soak your instrument. And that's all about. No? So this is why it is so important to have a very nice wood preparation. And later on, let's call them, we discovered, you, me, and all the rest of the world, that the instruments of the great masters were sounding very well. So by searching and understanding what's going on, they all arrived to the point that the great masters applied something which was very good for the resonance of the whole instrument. And now we know that it was this specific wood preparation, which was initially intended to be a wood preparation to protect the wood, that the oil varnish doesn't penetrate too much into the whole surface, into the whole violin. Yeah, because then the whole instrument would become only very heavy, but not good sounding, yeah? And this is where the Italians had discovered something that the other ones didn't discover. Then there were certain other tiny things, the archings, for instance. The Germans made too high archings, which with the new standard of sound and the new requirements after the Baroque violin was over and they wanted to have bigger concerts hall full with audience, they needed louder instruments. So with this secret preparation, the Italians made louder instruments, and that was exactly the winning difference. And that's why Cremona, even nowadays, is still very popular. And it's nowadays it's popular not because of the past, but now it's popular because there are so many makers here in town. And to make a living here, you really have to compete to many makers. Yeah. So I'm not alone here. And the customer who comes to Cremona has a very wide selection. And this is good for the musician, and certainly a very important part for all the makers to give their best. And that's why I'm here day and night for you, working, increasing, doing, and making the best I can make for you. It's a new experience for me here, working and talking, but it's nice actually. Okay, and I always like to clean the whole channel so it's a little bit more smooth to get in. It makes a little bit, takes away on the edge a little bit the sharp corners and makes the whole purfling get in easier. We'll have to adjust here a few steps here. And then sometimes I'm working and I forget that I'm here online with you, but I hope you appreciate that so you have a little bit this nice impression that you can see how a violin is made. A usually we're all working here, it's a lot of mess and we're talking, or sometimes we have the earplugs and we listen to something because everybody is listening to something else.
Here, how is this? Like this, okay. I probably will take the ribs and... or I take this one here. Goes quicker.
You cannot make this with one cut perfect. So what I usually do is that I make it for purpose wrong. I make one line too flat and the other one too curved. Then I take out the material and then I look and I adjust. Okay. So I sign it now.
Yeah. This is like a template which I have with different curves. It's usually used for drawing, but then I use it for
this kind of now I take my thin one and I take it out. And as soon as I take it out, then you actually see what you have created, because it is just like the rest because of the light amplifying much better the whole situation. And then I see that the underline is not correct and then I adjust it. Yeah. Still too thin, I cannot go with the other one.
You want to see that, right? Still have to adjust from the outer, from the other. The And some more. There's always something you could make better, right? And I'm here to do that. You want to see that now? Yep, I show you. So here, this is what I have made. Oops, it's a little bit dark here, right? You want to see it better by light. So we do it like this here. This is now too much light, right? Okay, here I just, because of the area here, you cannot go through with the signing with this tool, which is with the two plates, and then you can scratch here. You can also go quite deep, and then I just do a little bit more with the knife, and then I take out this. So where it goes quick, I do it immediately. Then I bend the linings how you saw before, and then I adjust the corners and I take away this. And you just saw how I took this away, and I hope you can see it, how it is nice. I just made it now here. And now I cut in here again the linings, right? So this is actually what we will do here. And while I cut the linings, I will also put on the glue. And the glue is another interesting area. Hold on, I'm soon back with you. I'm just taking here the glue. The glue. Oops, I have to change the water. This is somehow a pity. This is to warm up the baby bottle. Hold on, just go and fetch some water here. Change it and put the water. Yep, here we are again. So, where's all the electricity? That's over there. So we have to put it here. Hop. We have here in Europe. For those who don't know where I am, I'm here right now in Italy, in Cremona, by the way. I'm not in America. I'm here in Italy. Cremona, Italia. And I'm now putting the animal glue on the fire, which is like this. And then here, so now it's like on 17 degrees. 17 is pretty hope it's warming up. Then we see this one is turned off now. And I just want to see that temperature is raising. But meanwhile, I cut here these ones because I wanted to show you how I glue in my purfling here. So these ones we can actually then put away. And here I'm now cutting my purflings. I hope the temperature will raise here. Okay. And so like this, it's better. The first one is this one here, but this one goes up to here, so we do it a little bit until here, and then we first go with this one. And here on the back, we certainly have to make a joint. So I prepare already one with the joint. Ah, bless you. Gesundheit, how you say, right? Just like in Germany or in Austria. Yes, you're right. I'm not German. I am from Austria. Born in Austria, and then I came here with 17 years, and now we are here 54 years, 50, close to 55 years later, and I'm still here making my violins in Cremona, Italy. I guess you're surprised that I don't listen to music, but I cannot listen to classical music, sorry. What I can do is listen to one instrument, because then I just say, okay, it sounds how it sounds. But if I listen to an orchestra, I'm always searching for the instrument which has some problem, and I'm getting crazy. So it's only in a few moments that I can it's a little bit like the hairdresser has long hair, and the mechanics has a half broken car and stuff like this, you know. it's just you get like a maniac, you know, you become like a maniac. But sometimes I what I very much love is live music, and I love to go to concerts, and that's something I appreciate. And I don't, there I can just go drift away with my thoughts, and it's just relaxing. But recorded instruments, especially with headphones, where I'm just only doing this and then I'm working, is a very tough situation. Yeah, certainly. If you have something you want to ask me, you leave your comments down below here, or your contact.
And then I know who you were, that you were here, what you are interested in, and then I will come back to you as soon as I'm done here. Okay. Because I certainly want to know who is interested in what I'm doing. Very nice corner. I don't know if Storioni really made such nice corners, but I do it that way. Let me see if this works out. Slightly long, huh? Slightly too long, just a little bit away. Better. Very nice. Okay.
And then usually with a pencil,
I sign it because later I put the other side and then I don't find the joint. So this is the long side. Oh, temperature is going on 53 degrees, you see here, and it goes to 85 degrees. And when it's 85, which is actually the water is 85, not the glue might be 85 something, 80. Degrees Celsius, then I glue it in. When here, well, the nice thing of this fair is that it is very tranquil. Well, last year we had such a big mess. It was just incredible. Over there in the corner there was a saxophone playing every now and then. But so loud, it was just wow, we couldn't believe it, you know. But I understand that they wanted to show off there. And then on the back side, I had Stefano Trabucchi, he's also here. And just in front of his booth, there was live music with also with electric violin, something like this. It was also to be honest, I like it all this mess. If it wouldn't be that customers of ours couldn't actually try the instrument, that was just but that's okay. Once in a year, this is actually good to be in the mess. Otherwise, it's getting too silent here. Right. This looks actually great. And this one here. We have to cut in the right length. I hope you can see that it's not the first time that I put some purfling into a violin, because some people think that I'm not doing anything. Well, it is slightly different. I'm the one who makes my violins. Min, she works for the past 15, 16 years, something. No, 18, 20 years actually, is working with me like this. And she makes her instruments. And then my apprentice makes his instruments, Marco. And so everybody makes his own instruments. And then together we make the Scala Perfetta and the Linea Macchi. So we have plenty of time, there's plenty of work to do. And nobody's being annoyed here. But yeah, the point is that I make my instruments here, yeah, which makes the whole thing pretty stressy. But I think it is also interesting and good, and good for the whole stuff, for the quality of every instrument, that they see what I'm doing and how I would do, and I show them how I do. Otherwise, this would be not a master violin or a workshop in Cremona, Italy, yeah. So nah, what is going on here wrong? Like this, okay. Very good. So, how many degrees do we have? 72. I was a little bit too quick. This is now what I'm doing here. So, actually, I could go and fetch a coffee, drink my coffee, and then I glue in this purfling. Yeah. So, wow, the whole workshop is a little bit messy. So, I just go and fetch a coffee.
So this is how the whole thing goes, right? And if you want to see more of making, and you want more measurements and things like this, then you actually have to sign up in the Patreon. And otherwise, if you just think the whole thing is interesting and you are even playing the guitar, making guitars, I think you could also learn something from me. I have a lot of people who are very grateful for what they have learned during my videos of the YouTube channel. And then I just would say, join my YouTube channel, Edgar Russ, and distinguished violin maker. And you will find me, Cremona, Italy, and you will find me on YouTube. And if you subscribe, you would make me happy, because the more subscription I have, the more I will be suggested to new people who are interested in this subject. Okay, go and fetch my coffee. Let me see. Okay, that's good. Good or good? Very good. With a coffee like this in America, I would make a fortune. This now here is Chicco d'Oro. Otherwise, usually we have Lavazzo, Qualità Rossa, but I just wanted to see what other kind of coffees do we have, because the coffee machine is a new one. And Chicco d'Oro is not bad. Actually, when you're in Cremona, you have to go here. Just close, you go out here, Corso Mazzini, and then you go down 100 meters. You can walk easily. In Cremona, everything is walking distance, okay? So you don't need to be in a car. A car here is just a pain, you know, in town, because so many restricted areas that you get so many fines that you will probably next time you will leave the car just right after you get off the highway. But if you go down there, there's a torrefazione, tubino, and they have the coffee bean roastery, and they make their own coffee. This is just the non plus ultra of coffee. I never had anything better, you know. You can have then certainly other great coffees. Starbucks, they opened in Italy, but they had to close then. Now I don't know if they retried it again, but I shouldn't make this here. Don't have to convince you about our coffee culture in Italy. So I need here my tools to hammer in the purfling. Yep, this is what I love to have. Here I close the door, so then if there is no air blowing around. So I have two small hammers and a small, tiny, very old, I would rather say an antique syringe. Okay, so I put this in here, wash it a little bit. That's good to go. The soap we both put away. I make here a clean up a little bit, because otherwise the glue is all over the place and then I have difficulties to clean my tools later on. So I prefer to put away the things here. Hop. Mm. This was the knife which I have borrowed from Min, I think. I'm not sure if this was the knife. Oh no, this was the knife. This one was the knife I borrowed from her. Or was it this one? I don't remember, you know. Huh. I don't know. This one I need. This is to sharpen a little bit the tools. We could actually take away this one here. The book, we don't need to put all the dirt on it, right? Or the glue, so we put it here on the side, otherwise it's all only full. And then we have it like this, right? Very good. So I think it's nice for you if you can see it a little bit better, so I bring you a little bit closer. Okay, so I put it like this. Maybe even higher, and then from up down, what do you think? It would be probably... Just a little bit too white, the whole thing. For you, it's just so... This is getting better like this, right? Okay. We leave it like this. So now, I have cut in all the purfling. I adjusted all the pieces, but I didn't yet glue in the corners and all these things, right? So now I glue it in. And I show you how I glue this here. So here we have the top, and here we have this one, and here also the glue. Okay, so the glue we put like this here in front. So then I open the glue. I need a brush, sorry. We need a brush here for the glue. Very good. We have like two brushes. And then my syringe. And now, this is an enamel glue. I like to use a rabbit skin glue. To see if you can see that, what I did here. So I put in the glue into the channel, and then I glue it like this, and with this hammer I want to be sure that it is completely down and is attaching to the... You can even hear it when it is down, and then it is a different sound, right? This is good.
first see is the inside. Now we make the next C. You have to be quite quick, otherwise the whole glue is blowing up the whole channel, and then you cannot get in with the purfling anymore if you wait too much. And if you, wow, this one here slipped a little bit out. I guess so, let me see. And you have to watch out not to, hammer too strong. Otherwise, you take off the whole edge. And actually, I love to put it quite good inside, just slightly a little bit more than the heath of these purflings. And then first we glue this one, so. Right? This glue is smelling a little bit. So now I don't smash it in immediately completely, because here I didn't put the glue. So now I keep it in this position, and then from here I slowly go deeper, and then the glue is pushed into that area of the corner. Yeah. You can hear already actually that the purfling is all the way in the right area. You glue the glue, I clean it away, because if it's completely dry and I have to cut the channel later on, it would make all the tools within a sudden not cutting anymore properly. And that's something I don't want to have, right? And then I just bend it slightly and don't push it inside immediately. If you can see that the glue is coming up here in this area very nicely when I'm hammering. Okay, this is a small tiny Japanese hammer which I use for this kind of work. Then we do the upper part, the smaller end. And now the last one. Oops. I always wanted to show you during a fair in the past years when there was the fairs where we could go personally there to show you how I'm working. And now finally the perfect fair from my side where I can show you what I'm doing. The only problem that you are now here there and you probably want to talk with me while I'm doing this, and you just make it that you just let your comment down below, and then I can answer your questions. And if you're interested into the whole subject, you can actually you put it like this, so then you see it, and then I do this one here. Same thing here. I take out the C's, right? And then I put the glue. You can hear how this whole thing is with 85 degrees is really working tough here. It is to warm up the baby bottles. I make the next C. I hope you actually can see something, you know. Let's make it a little bit closer. And then you can see it better. How I put in here the glue. So now we have to glue in the upper parts, right? That was actually quite quick. Up, this was so good. Up, so. How you can see, I don't take out the corners, the complete corners, because then I would just, with the whole glue and everything, we have to redo. The whole. Corners, while if I just leave it, the glue goes into the corner by being pushed into that area, and that's what I'm doing, squeezing the whole purfling inside, right? I hope you can see that well, what I'm doing. this violin becomes a
Lorenzo Storioni copy.
It's very nice model. At least I like it very much because it has a very, very powerful E string. It's like the
last one, and then we have glued them in all because of your help. And all right. Very well. So then I clean here the edges, because next step then, when it is dry, I want to follow easy the edge to sign something. So quite clean. Very good. So this is now the glue. And And this is like this. Yeah. Yeah. So I think we were very brave. Yeah. So we can turn off the glue pot. And here I have to clean the hammer. Oops. Kind of nervous probably because of this new working experience together with you. But actually I enjoy it very much. And I look forward to answer to your comments down below. You can chat with me, leave me your contact and I can get back to you. Visit my website and my whole presentation here on the NAMM show. And let's keep in touch. And if you are not a musician, you're not a violin maker, subscribe to my channel and we keep in touch. And that would be just great. Thank you. I have to just make here a short break. Thank you. See you soon.